First of all, this is the Greenwich Village Historic District. For those of you who are don't have this map imprinted on your brain, like some of us do, it includes most but not all of Greenwich Village. It never goes quite up to 14th Street. It never goes farther east than University Place, and in fact, most of your University Place is not included. It doesn't go south of Washington Square until you get over here to 7th Avenue South. It comes up Hudson Street, then it goes to Greenwich Street, and comes across along south of Danforth Street and Horatio Street. So most, but not all, of the neighborhood of Greenwich Village is in there. And here's just some of what the Greenwich Village Historic District preserves and protects. Much of what we think of when we think of Greenwich Village and historic architecture and charm, these incredible rows of houses, this Redwood Row on 5th Avenue, and just sort of jumping back, this is Commerce Street where Sheridan Theater is. These are these wonderful Italian and Greek Revival rows in the middle of the neighborhood, McDougal Alley and Washington Mews, and an incredible array of churches in the neighborhood, and particularly relevant, I think, in terms of this issue of historic preservation. These two in yellow here, Washington Square Methodist and the old Presbyterian on 13th Street, actually no longer serve as churches. And I think it's highly unlikely that were it not for landmark designation that those buildings would still survive today, that they have been adapted and reused as a result. Here's some other examples of what being in the Greenwich Village Historic District can do. Now, this building, just across the street from where we are, is technically just one building outside of the Greenwich Village Historic District, which ends here. It's an individual landmark. It's the Sound of Wendy Club on 47th Street, but it more or less illustrates the point. This is what it looked like at the time of designation. Much of the facade had been stripped of its architectural ornament. Through the landmarking process over the years, that building has been beautifully, beautifully restored. Again, not saying it's something that would never happen without landmark designation, but certainly much, much less likely to be the case, to say nothing of the fact that there's a much greater chance that that building would not survive to this day were it not for landmark designation. Here's a building on McDougal Street. This is how it looked historically in 1940. This is how it looked at the time of designation in 1969. I know some people who actually like this. A lot of people say maybe it wasn't a step up. This is what it was restored to a couple of years ago, again, under the aegis of the Landmark Preservation Commission and Landmark Designation. Here on the corner of 8th Street and 5th Avenue is what was once one of a row of Gothic Revival mansions that lined lower 5th Avenue that they the elite of New York lived in the early to mid 19th century. Here again, by the time of designation in 1969, a lot of that ornament had been stripped away. It was not really particularly recognizable as this incredibly distinguished piece of architecture. Much of that has been restored today. It does still have ground for commercial uses, unsurprisingly, on 8th Street, so it's no longer have is a single family home with a scoop entrance here, but all that detail about the ground floor has really, really been beautifully restored. Let's talk about what happens when you don't have a landmark designation in Greenwich Village. So these are some of the buildings that within what is now the Greenwich Village Historic District that were lost prior to landmark designation. These were the Rhinelander houses demolished in the early 1950s. This is on the corner of 5th Avenue and Washington Square North on the west side. This is where 2 5th Avenue now is. This is the 10th Street Studio Building on 10th Street between 5th and 6th Avenues, which is not only an incredible work of architecture, but an incredible piece of not only Greenwich Village, but New York City and American history. It was the first building that was purpose-built as a communal art studio space, and really more or less invented, at least in America, the idea of a place of creating these sort of broad open spaces where artists would both live and work and create. And it made Greenwich Village, more than any other single building or any other single entity, it made Greenwich Village the center of the art world in New York City and in America for about a century. And it was sadly demolished in the 1950s. This is Rhinelander Row on 7th Avenue between, was that 12th and 13th Streets, where the O'Toole, well, used to be called the O'Toole Building, now it's the North Health Building, located. This row of houses was demolished in the 1930s. The Mark Twain House and the Hotel Brevoort on Lower 5th Avenue demolished around 1952 to make way for what's now the Brevoort apartment building. So Mark Twain had lived here. The Hotel Brevoort was a sort of a great center of culture and society in New York in the 19th century. Here we have the Jefferson Market Library, formerly Jefferson Market Courthouse, which we almost lost prior to landmark designation. It was actually saved not by landmark designation, but by a great, great crusade by neighborhood residents and activists. What it speaks to is the fact that before landmark designation, each one of these was a huge fight that many times was not won. This was one of the fortunate outcomes, but this building would have been lost otherwise. And here's some illustrations of what happened before the historic district was designated in this area. This is 101 West 12th Street at the corner of 6th Avenue. Pretty massive, bulky, fairly plain, simple white brick apartment building. These have somewhat come back into vogue in recent years, but I would say it's probably not what you would call the most charming building in Greenwich Village. I know many wonderful people who live there. No insult to them or the building, but this is certainly not the historic character of Greenwich Village. And here are some illustrations of buildings that were built just outside of the Greenwich Village Historic District after designation, which here again gives you a sense of what kind of development we've seen in the neighborhood when landmark designation was not in effect. This is the Georgetown Plaza and 303 Mercer Street. Between Broadway and Mercer, south of 8th Street. These are the two tallest buildings in Greenwich Village. They're each over 300 feet tall. This is the Memphis over on Charles Street on the far west side, a block off of the waterfront, which definitely generated a lot of agita when it was built in the late 80s. The Meyer Towers here, three of them also on the waterfront. Again, whatever their virtues are, certainly a very different character than what we think of in terms of the Greenwich Village Historic District. Now here, switching gears a little bit, these are actually buildings that the Landmarks Preservation Commission allowed to be demolished within the Greenwich Village Historic District. So this is interesting to sort of think about. Landmark designation doesn't freeze things in amber forever. With the commission's permission, buildings can be demolished, new buildings can be built, and changes can be made to buildings. It's a much more highly regulated system, but I think this is good fodder for our conversation. This was the Lowe's Sheridan Theater, where now the St. Vincent's Park and AIDS Memorial is, where Greenwich Avenue and 7th Avenue meet. This was demolished in the late 1960s to make way for what was a sort of perfectly open space for St. Vincent's Hospital, where they basically just had some mechanical buildings. And this was the original St. Vincent's Hospital, which the commission allowed to be demolished to be replaced by what then became the new St. Vincent's Hospital in the late 1970s and early 1980s. Clearly a beautiful, beautiful work of architecture. And certainly a building with quite a bit of history. Here's a little bit simpler, but certainly beloved by some. This was the Art Greenwich Theater on Greenwich Avenue and 12th Street, which the commission allowed to be demolished in the late 90s and the early 2000s, replaced by a four-story building where the Equinox Sports Club now is. This is a more recent example, and I think it's indicative of what's a sort of broader trend that we see in the area. A pretty simple garage building at 11 to 19 Jane Street, which about 2 or 3 years ago the commission allowed to be demolished. It's being replaced by a much larger apartment building. Certainly, I don't think anybody could reasonably argue that this is an architectural masterpiece. On the other hand, some would argue it's kind of part of the vernacular fabric of the neighborhood. And if all of these disappear and are replaced by bigger, larger buildings, what does that do to the overall character of the neighborhood? Just very recently, this is in the process of going through the Landmarks Preservation Commission right now. This is Greenwich Avenue here, and this is 10th Street. So this is a late 19th century addition to what had been a house, a one-story structure that's at the rear of the building. This is what the developer is seeking to do, get rid of that and replace it with this. This raises two questions. One is it appropriate to allow the demolition of the original building? And if it is this an appropriate replacement for it? So far, the commission seems to have indicated that they do believe that it is acceptable to demolish this building. They have not yet accepted this design as a suitable replacement. So I'm going to try to quickly run through. This is a report that we issued first about 2 years ago, and then we updated earlier this year. It is a catalog of every single new building that has been approved for construction in the Greenwich Village Historic District over the last 50 years. Believe it or not, there's no single place where a record of all such buildings and approvals exist. So we actually got to do some painstaking research to find all of that, and we laid them out in chronological order to give the public a sense of what these buildings are. So the very first one was St. John's in the Village Church. There had been an old historic church on the site, some of you may remember. It burned, and this was the first time that somebody had applied for permission to build a new building in Greenwich Village, and it's in a sort of modernist idiom, but referencing historical styles. And actually, the architect, Edgar Taffel, who was a protege of Frank Lloyd Wright, is also the architect of the addition to First Presbyterian Church, just around the corner, the part of the church that we all tried to get into, but it's almost come around to this side. That one was actually built before landmark designation, so it didn't go through that approval process, but this one did. This gas station, long story behind that one, probably not the most interesting one in the deck. Here's an incredibly interesting one that there was a huge amount of debate about. This was the row house on 11th Street that had been blown up by the Weatherman Bomb Factory in 1970. And it's part of a pretty uniform row of these Greek Revival houses. And you know, some people felt that what should be done is you should build a Greek Revival house like the one that had been there before, filling in the continuous row and basically recreate what had been there before. Some people, I think, would have liked a fully modern addition. Ultimately, what was approved was this, which some argument showed that there was this disruption in the course of history which had taken place, but that there was also some continuity that was being sewn back together with the new building as well. So as you can see, at the top and at the base, it actually continues the original Greek Revival row pretty faithfully, but in the middle, it takes the midsection and kind of transforms it and juts it out as a way of saying, this isn't like the others, something different. So this is the building that eventually replaced what was that Lowe's theater for St. Vincent's. It's since been replaced by the park that's there. This is a building on 11th Street at the very far western edge of the district, kind of relatively non-district building. This was the old large section of St. Vincent's Hospital. Not the prettiest building in the neighborhood. It was clearly, when the commission was considering this, I don't think their top priority was, in fact, aesthetics when they were thinking about this one. Here's a building, so now we're getting to kind of the postmodern era in the 1980s, an infill building on 7th Avenue South, where there were all these leftover sort of triangular plots of land from when 7th Avenue South was extended. Very sort of postmodern, in some ways referencing traditional forms with this kind of pseudo cornice, but kind of mixing it up. And we see more of that during this era. Here was another building that was very, very controversial at the time. This had been a parking lot on 6th Avenue between Waverly Place and Washington Place, designed by Polshek Partners. I'll say that personally, I think they did a really fantastic job with this. They had a very, very large site. What they did was they broke it up so that it didn't feel overwhelming, like it was a single monolithic building. They used a lot of sort of motifs or design elements that reference traditional architecture, but in a sort of somewhat new and modern way. I know other people may feel differently, but it's in many ways, I think probably along with the Weatherman House, probably the two sort of flashpoint buildings in terms of discussing what is or is not appropriate in terms of new architecture in Greenwich Village. This was a parking garage that was replaced by this little sort of pseudo mews on Greenwich Street in 1986. This building here is just around the corner from it, actually on 10th Street and Hudson. This is another wing of St. Vincent's Hospital that came a little bit later in 1987, the low wing in front of it. Here again, we see this sort of postmodern design for these little infill buildings on 7th Avenue. There's either nothing there or just a one-story building. It was later changed. The commission approved a sort of redesign of the facade years later. The Witch's Hat building, as it's sometimes called, on the corner of Perry Street and 7th Avenue South. A very kind of postmodern take on a traditional Greenwich Village building. You see many buildings in Greenwich Village that have this sort of element at the corner, which in some ways references the sort of idiosyncratic street grid there, and in a sort of playful way acknowledges it. This does it at a sort of much larger scale. The New York Sports Club building, well, I think it's no longer New York Sports Club, actually, on 7th Avenue South. This is as originally approved, and now they're in the process of building a three-story addition on top of it, both of those approved by the Landmarks Preservation Commission. This building here on the corner of Charles and Hudson Street, which replaced the old Dover garage, that was the one that was used in the TV series Taxi. This is the building that replaced that Greenwich Art Theater on Greenwich Avenue and 12th Street. This sort of little, relatively inoffensive building here on the corner of Hudson and Horatio. This one here, which I have to tell you, I passed many times myself and did not realize it was a new building. So sometimes that is an approach that is taken, is to really just kind of try to do it exactly as if it was an old building that had been there forever. This building at the head of Gay Street on Christopher Street, which was approved in 2002. This very modernist, actually I think you could even call it constructivist, house that was built. It's the northernmost lot in Greenwich Village Historic District, where it borders the meatpacking district. So the commission felt that it was appropriate for it to have a more kind of industrial sort of look to it and materials. This more traditional building on Greenwich Avenue and 11th Street, approved in 2004. This is just one block south of the Whole Chef building that we were discussing before on 6th Avenue. Then we have a series of houses that replaced this little two-story building that had been highly altered over time on 4th Street. This one, and this one. So you can see these went the traditional route. This one went a not-so-traditional route. These are actually, I believe, shipping containers or something that are part of the construction of the building. And then, talk about non-traditional. This is 122 Greenwich Avenue, also at the northernmost end of the district. For me, personally, this is a head-scratcher. I actually love modern and contemporary architecture. I don't see how this relates to the character of the Greenwich Village Historic District. Other people may feel differently. I think it makes for an interesting debate. We were very surprised when the commission approved that design. It was a parking lot. There was no denying that a building should go there. The question really was the design. This was approved by the commission in 2008, but has never been built on the corner of Christopher and Hudson. This is a building that was approved at Washington and Perry, this sort of wavy building. It was approved, but then a new owner decided to go with another design, which we'll see in a moment. This was yet another iteration of that same project that was also approved by the commission and never built. This is a single family mansion on the corner of 12th Street in Greenwich, approved by the commission. It looks a little bit like it looks a little bit like a silo. It has a very sort of ominous kind of feeling to it. These were the new designs for St. Vincent's Hospital that were approved by the commission, but then the hospital went bankrupt and it was never built. This is in addition to St. Luke's School. These are the townhouses that replaced parts of St. Vincent's Hospital. This is the main new residential building that was built on the St. Vincent's Hospital site. This was a new building that was planned for the St. Vincent's Hospital site on 12th Street, but was never built, because ultimately they preserved the existing building after pressure from the community to do so. The AIDS Memorial on St. Vincent's Park. This new building, which has more or less just been completed on 7th Avenue South. Here again, one of these sort of triangular leftover sites on 7th Avenue South, but much bigger than the ones that we've seen before, which is reflected, I believe, of how the commission was allowing and has been allowing a larger scale of construction in the district. This one, this is a red ring, but it's now been built on 7th Avenue South and Perry Street. This very controversial addition to the St. Luke's campus on Barrow Street at Greenwich Street. This little building, which is just a reconstruction of the building that's there now, that is to be done because the building is falling apart and could not be saved. This is the final version of that one that we've seen two times before on the corner of Washington and Perry. This is going to be a single family mansion along with an apartment building for the owner's children. Interestingly, it's a bit smaller than the ones that were approved, which we actually thought the designs were fairly appropriate, and people always accused us of that, you know, we're against it, and all we want is things to be as small as possible. In that case, we actually thought the larger design was more appropriate. Here, our objection was, this just doesn't look like anything in Greenwich Village. It looks more like something you would see on Rodeo Drive or in the Miami Design District, and not in the West Village. This is the building that is replacing the little garage on James Street that we were looking at before. And this is going to be going up on the floor. It is slated to go up. It was approved for construction on the corner of Hudson and Charles. And the very last, the most recent new building approved by the commission, it's actually a single building but made to look like two, that is supposed to go up on the corner of 8th Street and McDougal. So this is a map showing where all of those approved buildings in the Greenwich Village Historic District are. So as you can see, it's a not insignificant number. And the speed of new building approvals has definitely increased over the years. In the first 23 years of the district's existence, there were 14 buildings approved, so that's one about every 1.64 years. In the next 17 years, 16 buildings, so one just a little over every year. And then finally, in the last 8 years, they've approved 13 buildings. So it's now, they're now coming one every 7.5 months. So this tells us something about how things are changing. And then, all right, I'll wrap up quickly here. So we're definitely seeing a lot of applications for things like this, which is people taking the sort of lovely little old houses and just blowing them up as big as they can make them go. Adding stories on top, adding additions in the back, as well as digging down and excavating underneath the building. So that's definitely a big issue that we face. This is too long a story, I'm going to skip it. And then this is one that's coming down the pipe, or maybe coming down the pipe, which I'd like to discuss. About 2.5 years ago, plans were leaked to build this 367-foot tall tower on Lower Fifth Avenue in the Historic District between 8th and 9th Street, actually just two doors up from that restored Gothic building that I showed you on the corner of 8th and 5th Avenue. It's designed by Robert A. M. Stern. The rumor is that they are going to be coming to the commission soon with a proposal, albeit maybe a modified version of what was released a couple years ago when there was such a firestorm of controversy. And the commission is going to have to decide whether or not it's acceptable to demolish this building here at 14th Fifth Avenue, which used to look like this, used to look like that building on the corner of 8th Street and Fifth Avenue. Some famous artists lived there over the years, but it was stripped of ornament in the 1930s. So you're going to have to answer two questions. One is it okay to get rid of this building? And then if it is it okay to replace it with this building? I'll give you a little spoiler. Our answer to both of those questions is no. But it remains to be seen what that commission will say. And so that's it. That's hopefully that will provide some fodder, but we're going to go well beyond that to kind of talk about the district. And so I first want to open it up to the three of you, and I'm just going to have the one microphone to figure out what the easiest way is. But the first question I'd like to ask you is, what do you think the Greenwich Village Historic District would look like were it not for landmark designation? I'm going to come over here.
Okay, I'm not.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Okay, cool. So.
Let's see.
All right, so what are your thoughts in terms of what the district would look like to have a market designation, right? You know, 50 years later.
Go first. Okay, I'll start. First, full disclosure, my cousin was the builder of the biggest house in the town.
So what his house of intention was next to Jefferson Market Courthouse, which was demolished in 1974. It was the only Art Deco, you probably all know this, but the only Art Deco prison in the world. It was only for women. And it was demolished by, I think, Mayor Lindsay. And I think the question then becomes, what is architecture and what is our perception of architecture? Because I think a lot of what we're saying is, by the way, it's fantastic. It's really great, you know, picture of it. But it's what are we bringing to the buildings that we're looking at? So I question whether that building will be demolished today, and I just kind of throw that out to everybody. But I'm in Yorkville, and I think if you looked at photographs of Yorkville in the 1950s and photographs of Greenwich Village, you would have not the same feel, but you'd have a lot of tenements, brownstones, institutional buildings, they're all gone. So I tell you that your neighborhood would look like Brookville, which we have a lot of glass buildings, we have a couple of landmarks. It's a very, very different feel, and we're dying for the context that you have. And I think in terms of what was designated, I think we also have to think about what was the city like in the 1960s and what was the perception of Greenwich Village at the time. Because remember, when it was designated, I think, that it was still it was an Italian section. Right, it was very much clusters of
buildings. They avoided including the landmark districts at that time.
They very much didn't want that section. Right. So, you know, what were the city fathers? What was everybody thinking? What were tourists thinking? What was the perception of the landmark section? So I think looking at this, and there are some dreadful things. And there are some questions that we have, but I think the other thing that we gain by landmarking is that as time goes on, there's better materials, there's better technical expertise, which at the time when you were designated as well, those guys were dead, right? And now they're back. So you have a greater chance of bringing back whatever is missing. So I think whatever you have is fabulous, and you just have to work on figuring out how to make the next, the new ones fabulous, but it would look nothing like this.
Yes. Okay. And then I'm not going to be your chance to say it. So, come closer. Just to know where I'm coming from, I got out of Columbia in 1969. Barbara Goldstone came, he was chairman of the commission, he came to my thesis presentation. So I went to work at the commission, I think it was probably in March 1969. And the first thing that happened was the Greenwich Village got designated as a historic district. So to answer, Andrew, your question directly, I thought there would be a lot more modern buildings in Greenwich Village. I was coming out of the ethic at Columbia was that you should never replicate a historic building, that you should always build a compatible building that would be contextual, but there should be no doubt that it was a new building. So I figured that in all the holes that were in Greenwich Village, and especially along the avenue, that they would look pretty new. I knew, and even at the time, that the commission was the only thing holding the scale then. And that's proven true. I mean, the City Planning Commission hasn't really done that, and the Board of Standards and Appeals appears to approve any kind of variance. That hasn't changed. So if it weren't for the commission doing the jobs of other agencies, I think the village would have all kinds of high buildings, like the stupid thing that is being proposed for Fifth Avenue. But I did anticipate that scale would get bigger, and that never happened. So I guess my two immediate questions are, the scale didn't get bigger, and there are not as many modern buildings. And I guess the third part is, I never would have expected there would be so many fake old buildings.
I'm not sure, I wonder if you have in your bag a trick to include an image of what the commission originally proposed for Greenwich Village.
So,
in the beginning of the historic district, ever since, there's this unresolved conflict between the architectural, the perspective of the architectural historian, which is to figure out what the really good buildings are, and draw a circle around them, and the perspective of the lawyers, which is that you can't do that, and you have to have a coherent place. And the real hero of Greenwich Village is Norman Wedlich, who was the corporation counsel in at the time in the Lindsay administration. And when Harvey Goldstone and another commissioner, a brilliant caring went with their maps, which I think were there 8 districts or 9?
There was 17.
15, 16.
Yeah, you'll never know when you're in this district or when you're out of this district. There has to be a sharing of benefits and burdens. And I believe myself, that's exactly the right answer. But it always made architectural historians nervous. And it makes politicians nervous because they say, well, how can you possibly put that a gas station in there? But I think that I agree with Frank, the quality of the architecture, and I think we should come back to that, hasn't been exactly what one would have hoped, with exceptions like the culture that Andrew's talking about. That overall, the fact that throughout this district, we have there is a necessity of getting change approved as having a benign effect. This lesson is not secure. There are still, every time somebody proposes an historic district, you go right back to that same question. We'll do a historic district, but we'll leave out the avenues. That's where development should occur. We'll leave out that. And the next thing we know, you have these little Chinese gardens.
Don't you think that it was crucial to put the avenues in? Because without controlling the avenues, you really didn't scare off. But I think the avenues, the major contribution that's been made is that the scale is held back.
Yes.
That's the major contribution. But one contribution I would like to make right now, and see what everybody else thinks about this, is that one thing that is obvious to me looking at these slides is that there has not been a great building designed in Greenwich Village. And I think the reason for that is you can't design by committee, and you can't have it both ways. The village generally hangs together, and that's really good. And I think one of the reasons is because the commission has pushed toward masonry, and the one example you showed of that building up above on the boundary is glass, and it looks weird. But in pushing toward masonry and in sticking their finger in every design, I think there is no great architecture. So I would ask the question, if you were designating a place that has great architecture in it from various periods, what is the future of that district not to have great architecture from the 20th century going forward? And is that what we want in a historic district?
Well, so I think, something that I think about this district as opposed to some of the others is that it is still quirky, right? It still contains that quirk. And so the question, whether you have these signs for a district where you really are, you're constantly going back to the old idioms, was it a place like uni building, I'm looking at this, oh my God, if we had known that simply putting the steps back, walk that building back, we would not have, you know, kind of gone crazy with this modern building. Now, I just, I, did they think about it at the time? No, because that was not proposed. So that's your, you know, your committee, right? It's the owner, right? It's the architect, it's the commission, it's the public. So it's really, you know, who wants what?
And that's, there's always a client architect relationship. The difference is, it's called a commission deciding what's appropriate and what's not, which I, by premises, it stifles excellence.
What is the different question? Is it different in Brooklyn Heights, the oldest historic district, where there were modern infill buildings from the very beginning? Is that the more successful? Something particular about, and you, everyone in this room knows there is something different about Berman Church. And when I was 17, going to community board meetings, listening to some of the surrounding area, Bob Weinberg and Ruth Wittenberg interrogating architects and developers. This was never an easy place. And so it may have been Greenwich Village is more discouraging to that sort of innovation than other places, but I don't know whether that's true. Many of us overlap, but there was a perpetual argument against the commission by Commissioner Tony Tom, which was that she designated the district like Greenwich Village because of the security of the architect. When you zoom an infill building, it's a commercial storefront or a new building on Main Street, that has to rise to a much greater level of artistic success than a building somewhere else. That perspective, of course, has led to hundreds of hours of Tony torturing, you know, architects who just there to get something approved home for dinner. but it's a real question. And how do you get those better buildings? It wasn't always clear. Frank's perspective is interesting to me because he and I were there at the same time. And you don't have every building in this presentation. I remember around the time of the witch's hat, there was a, what was his name, an architect from Hudson River Valley, did a lot of restoration work. No, it wasn't Joe Williams, and it wasn't that. A perfect 18th century building was approved building in the West Village. So no more relationship to the late 20th century than anything it could have. But the feeling was, well, it's valid as long as it's clear that it wasn't built in, you know, 1780 to do that. I don't think it is valid. We were all products of our time. I'm very much of the Frank described as the Harvard Goldstone perspective. You have to remember to be true to your time, or even if it just means inflicting a small change on the building on 11th Street. I'd like to say something about the building on 11th Street. It was such a strong fight. There were so many brilliant people on all sides of this. Finally, the issue became
one is probably, to my mind, the most creative one, because it just, it's thoughtful. I mean, was a wonderful architect, Hugh Hardy, who thought of a lot of things, and he embodied his thought in this building, and it is contextual, but you're not confused by looking at it, as Andrew said, something I haven't heard of, and I've been, that kind of thing is what I don't see happening very much, and I'm, you know, like Jim Hoshek's building on 6th Avenue, the Putney House, that really is a wonderful contextual building. I think it really fits in. And maybe in 6th Avenue, that's the right thing to do, but I'm convinced that like on 7th Avenue and 7th Avenue South, there could have been much better buildings than what we've come up with there. Which are just... But, so you have to release somebody to do that. There was a building that came through here by Annabelle Sullivan, which is one of the darlings of current architectural design in New York City. Well, it looks kind of like a bunker to me, anyway. I think it's a great building. I don't know how much that thing was controlled by the commission, but just because it's brick and it's scale, maybe they went up.
Well, I will tell you, this is more or less the design she came there with.
Yeah.
Now, there may have been prior conversations that led to her arriving at that, but similarly, for better or worse, I will also tell you, we're really surprised by this, the commission didn't change bricks. It came to them this way, and they approved it exactly as is. Again, maybe there were behind-the-scenes conversations beforehand that shaped it into what it was, but in some of these cases, at least overtly, the commission has a very, very light touch in terms of what they're doing.
So let me bring up two other points which you mentioned that I just want to focus on. I think that when I started the commission, I was there twice. I started in 69, I left back in 71, I came back in 78, and I stayed there a long time. I worked my way up and became executive director for about a year or so. So I was working there, improving things at staff level. One thing that we all used to say is the village is going to, I think we're pretty proud to say this, the village is going to die bit by little bit if we don't watch every window bunting and every lintel and every frame. And, you know, it didn't. I mean, I think we're kind of counter to that. But you were showing how so many buildings have actually had their significant features restored to them. That was amazing. So that was wrong. The other thing that I want to mention is how, what a difference I think cultural designation is going to make, and the way preservation is headed to recognize more than just architecture. Because I'll bet those two movie theaters wouldn't have disappeared. And, you know, the one was replaced by open space, which may be necessary, but I don't think that it would disappear. And I also think what Ruth used to call the malocclusion building, the overbite. I think if attitudes have changed about modern architecture, that would become also very big.
The two of you raised two great issues that I want to hit on. And by the way, I just have to say there's so many great things we could be talking about tonight. We're obviously not going to hit on everything, but so the Women's House of Design, I think you raised a great point. It's actually, I think, the rare case where if it had happened today, the commission would have been more restrictive in the word that they might not have allowed the demolition of the building because they would have recognized the sort of historical and cultural significance of it, which was the most gated building in Greenwich Village at the time. And I think it was actually preservationists who were rallying for it to be demolished. But I also want to...
That was the architect, right? Because of the
bed. Let's pause there for a moment.
Sure.
First of all, the success of the Jefferson Court Courthouse... The success of the Jefferson Court Courthouse, of course, contributed to the demise of the Women's House of Detention. extend the duty of the box building. And the difference where the courthouse went, you know, and was promoted, respected buildings in America in the 19th century to a building that was hated. My mother thought that the Jefferson Memorial Courthouse was about the army's building, she herself. The social consequences, when you stood in the line in Sutter's on Sunday morning to get your croissant, with your little children, and the, somebody said, the boyfriends, the pimps of the detainees were on the streets. Orders were being shouted back and forth, and sometimes colorful language was being used on the garlands on the way home from church. So there was I don't think there was much romance at the time, but in retrospect, there was. It was about the architectural and the scale in the country. But the architectural movement hadn't come forward. Industrial buildings at the west part of the district, but nonetheless it was a place to begin.
looking at districts that are not exclusively architecture, right? They're not, you know, they're based on, you know, culture, history, architecture, ambiance, and this is not a kind of district that would happen. And I think now we're looking back at some of these districts. Now, I thought that non-contributing buildings were only on the Upper East Side. I didn't think that they were, no, formally.
No, there's, that's no formal, there's a new one. What's there is no spot.
No spot, and strict. So I think.
It's just code for the entire town.
Right. But, you know, I think the point that there's some nuance, but when there's really nothing there, I think that's troubling.
Well, I think non-contributing is only in terms of the architecture. So I think now we have to consider a building on different terms. Stone walls are just example. Stone wall, the description in the historic district report was quite nodding. It's a stable that's been changed or something like that. And so I guess maybe one point is that with the district nomination, which is 50 years old, it is definitely worth reconsidering. Now, I only remember Dorothy Minor was always terrified of changing anything because it opened all kinds of doors. However,
which the commission has never done,
which I've never done. But it kind of leaves you in a tough spot because there's so much more known about things and issues have changed, like the appreciation of modern architecture, which wasn't there. And I wonder if those early district reports shouldn't be reevaluated and maybe not go with contributing and non-contributing, but at least be a little more thoughtful than they are now.
There's no harm in adding additional information. I think the harm is making a judgment.
Making it, and today's judgment could be wrong 50 years from now. So that's the tough one.
And up to this point, the commission hasn't been willing to do that. It's definitely something that we've kind of grappled with internally, just in terms of what we would advocate for and ask for. There's definitely a lot of those old reports that we would say, there's really important stuff that's missing here that, you know, should have the cultural history, a greater appreciation for understanding. On the other hand, you know, there's a lot of other folks who probably like to see changes to those designation reports as well. People with lots of money and lots of access, etc. So there is the fear that if you start opening that up, what comes out of that, you know, can't hold on just if you did. And that's part of the
problem. Two other things we have to do, which I should remember. One of them is adaptive use. Mm-hmm. When you touched on a bit from the churches, I don't know how much adaptive use has gone on in the village, but to hear from other people, having a building has been used for something else. And the other thing that's worth talking about is changing technology, and that St. Vincent's is probably the best place to talk about that, because if anything's got to be up to date, it's a hospital. There's a major hospital facility in the Berman Greenwich Village. So it seems to me that that is going to keep changing. One maybe could have made the argument at the beginning with the original St. Vincent's building, if it had been there, that it would have been worth gutting it and putting it in a brand new building inside and keeping the outside. With all of the replacement buildings, there's nothing great enough to keep. Which brings up another point. That being, should the commission go back in the district like the village where there are new buildings built and decide which ones deserve to be protected because of the design of the new building?
Yeah, that's a, I'd love to hear your thoughts about that. I know it came up a lot with Pier 17 at the South Street Seaport, and there's a building that the commission approves, presumably meaning they think this is an appropriate addition to the district. Can somebody then come along a couple years later and say, well, hey, I want to turn around and build a new building that I'm going to try to convince you is appropriate? I mean, if somebody came along and said, you know, I want to get rid of this, would that be appropriate? I mean, it's not historic per se, but it was a design that was approved by the commission as appropriate for the district.
And it's 30 years old. It's 30 years old. So
syphilis showing up, kicking shins, is still the greatest force in the world. So you have the intellectual argument of the project that is approved, so it's been more than 30 years, so it should be treated as a treasure, a historic building. I'm not sure you're getting too far across the board in that argument. Why would somebody change that building if they can't change the scale? You didn't change, we haven't talked quite enough about scale in the exhibition. I believe that I've never said this before, but in fact, I'm slightly mistaken in saying that there's no scale structure. After Greenwich Village was designated, the city now zoned it. And they did a number of nights in Berman City Park. So that was an excuse for planning. Children started in the water and this was happy to go there. He was happy to see Greenwich Village designated. He was happy to see it downzoned. And it's such a contrast.